We got go now? Okay, we had a little technical difficulty. You just tuned in to Rescue the Lost Ministry. My name is John Fontana for this evening's Bible study. We have an excellent one for you this evening. It's called, What is Salvation? What is Salvation? Okay, before that, as usual, we'll give you our computer info. We're Rescue the Lost Ministry, as I stated, and we have we're Christians who equip and train believers who are burdened for the lost. Our phone number is 1-877-676-2288. That's 1-877-676-2288. Skype, Selah Radio 1. Our email address is raise4him@yahoo.com. Raise, R-A-Y-Z, the number 4, for him at yahoo.com. You can join our Facebook page, live chat on soulwinnerswithaz.org, Facebook, Spreaker. You can listen on TuneIn app for iPhone, iPad, iPod, and all Android devices. Enter Selah Radio 24/7 in search. Well, as promised, what is salvation? It's an excellent one this evening. You'll really be blessed, and we hope you enjoy it. And by the way, thank you for tuning in. The Bible contains many topics. And in our previous webcasts, we have covered studying specific subjects, many pertaining to Christian life and witnessing. This evening, our topic or word study is salvation. What is salvation, specifically by the title? Salvation has both a general and a particular sense. In general, it means a release from difficulty, danger, loss, or other crippling circumstance. Persons are spoken of as being saved, quote-unquote, from illness, starvation, oppression, ignorance, calamity, and death. There is much of this in the Old Testament, chiefly because of the Hebrew tendency to identify God's favor with physical and material well-being. As for the particular sense, the word salvation means deliverance from sin and its consequences and coming to peace and reconciliation with God. This is the religious meaning, and it is sometimes called the salvation of the soul, which we'll talk about later. The word salvation, incidentally, appears approximately 132 times in Scripture. So in sharing our faith with the unsaved, salvation should be properly understood by believers first, for it to be properly understood by the lost. And our ministry, Rescue the Lost Ministry, is designed to train and equip believers, as I said in the opening, to not only understand salvation, but to present Jesus Christ as friend, Savior, deliverer, and hope to the world. Jesus' name, Yeshua, means salvation in the Hebrew. And Acts 4:12 says, "There is no salvation by any other man, for there is no other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved." So it's imperative that happens through Christ and Christ alone. Man cannot save himself or make it into heaven by good works, lest any man boast. It's not by his merit, only through Christ. It is God's will that all men be saved, 1 Timothy 2:4. For he is not willing that any should perish, but all reach repentance, in 2 Peter 3:9. When witnessing, you want to clearly and simply explain terms in Scripture you may know, like sin and repentance, but the unsaved don't know. Don't assume they understand what you do. The aforementioned verses are the scope of salvation. Salvation is extended by God to everyone. It's as far-reaching as everyone. Then you could recite to him a verse like John 1:12, "But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children or sons and daughters of God. Let them know flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 15:50, that they must be born again of God's Spirit to see and enter the kingdom of God, John 3:3-5. You see, a few days ago, I was witnessing to a young man who thought, like many do, we're all God's children. We are all created by God, but must receive him through the new birth to become his child. You can show the unsaved when they bring this up, Romans 8:9, which says that if you don't have the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, you do not belong to him, to Christ. The more you unfold the word of God to people, the more enlightened they're going to be. In explaining sin, show the unsaved it is man's problem, that Jesus died for sin, which separates them and alienates them from God through rebellion. You can show them Isaiah 59:2. Sin has made a separation between you and your God. You could have an open Bible and show them, or you memorize the verse and tell them. Isaiah 53:6, we like sheep have gone astray from God in our independence, rebellion, and sin. And because of it, we've all turned to our own evil way. Well, let's go into a greater depth and understanding about the scope of salvation. Now, this is a key verse that we're going to explain for a while. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it says, "May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you wholly and make your spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, there's an awful lot in this verse about salvation. According to this verse, it clearly portrays man as possessing three important elements: spirit, soul, and body, in that order. The spirit is that faculty by which man is able to commune with God. The soul, on the other hand, is man's organ for thought, will, and emotions. And lastly, the body is that part of man which communicates with the material world. Since we human beings are composed of spirit, soul, and body, our salvation must accordingly reach all these three parts. This is salvation in three dimensions. That is why it says in Hebrews 7:25, "Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost," to that extent. Come to God by him, seeing he ever lives to make intercession for them. This verse speaks of full salvation of the body, soul, and spirit. Complete salvation. When Jesus saves us, he does a complete job. However, salvation is progressive. It covers the past, present, and future. We were saved the day we came to Jesus. That was initial salvation. That was the past. We are being saved, that's the present, and we will be saved pertaining to the future, that the Spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. This speaks of the salvation of the Spirit, Romans 8:23. The latter part of the verse speaks of the redemption of our bodies. This tells of the salvation of the body. 1 Peter 1:9 says, "And you will receive the reward for your faith, the salvation of your souls. At the outcome of your faith, we obtain the salvation of our soul." Once we are with the Lord, one day in the future. Watchman Nee writes, "The spirit is saved through Christ bearing the cross for you, for me and you. The soul is saved by you and I bearing our cross. And the spirit is saved because Christ lays down his life for you and me. The soul is saved because you and I deny ourselves and follow the Lord. The spirit is saved on the basis of faith, once having believed. The soul is saved on the basis of following Christ. It is a lifelong matter, a course to be finished. By faith, the spirit is saved because he that believes in the Son has eternal life, John 3:36. through works the soul is saved, because then shall the Lord render unto everyone according to his deeds, as found in Matthew 16:27. You see, once the Spirit is saved, eternal life is assured. The salvation of the Spirit is decided today, because by believing in the Lord, one has eternal life. The salvation of the soul, however, is to be decided at the coming of the Son of Man. The salvation of the Spirit is a current gift. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, John 3:16. The salvation of the soul, though, is a future reward given at the time of the Lord's return to those eagerly waiting for him and faithfully following him. In order for the soul to be saved, a person must have the Spirit of God first. Without the salvation of the Spirit, there is no possibility of having the soul saved. Should a believer remain wholly bent towards sin, it proves he or she is of the flesh and has not yet appropriated full salvation. The Lord Jesus is able to influence us and bend us away from sin, but in addition, we must be watchful. Under the influence of the world and the temptation of Satan, the possibility of sinning stays with us. Watchman Nee writes, "Regeneration gives us life. Resurrection gives us life more abundantly. God's salvation causes the Lord Jesus to live in us as well as to die at Calvary for us. He not only pays all our sin debt, but also lives in us so that we will never have to run into debt again. If you have received only half of this salvation, you will undoubtedly be miserable and fail to experience the full joy of salvation." You see, salvation deals with what I have come out of, as well as what I enter into. I have come out of the world, for the world says, For the word says in 2 Corinthians 6:17, "Come out from them and be separate from them, and don't touch the unclean thing, and I will receive you." Verse 18 says, "And I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, said the Lord Almighty." The next chapter, chapter 7, verse 1 says, "Having therefore these promises, my beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness and defilement of the flesh or soul and spirit, and let us serve in holiness in the fear of God." Once a believer fellowships with the world, he touches the spirit of the world that contaminates and defiles his soul and spirit, and he then needs to be purged or cleansed. For the scripture says light cannot fellowship with darkness. Of course, false religion is included in the world system that also should be avoided. We as the corporate body of Christ, his church, are called in the Greek ecclesia, the called out ones. Salvation has to do with the root cause, not sin, but self. Sin is the effect. That's why Jesus said, "If you want to follow me, first deny yourself." To die to self is an experience deeper and more advanced than dying to sin. "Apart from the Lord, we can do nothing," John 15:5. Only he has shown us and accomplished for us a way to the death of self. And it is none other than the cross. To deny self is a matter that should never cease. Paul said, "I die daily," 1 Corinthians 15:31. The cross is a principle, and this principle is to deny self and depend on God. In our witnessing, we are letting the unsaved know that self-reliance is the cause of all defeats. Man being into self, self-destructs and fails in everything in his independence apart from God. The way of salvation is not in God making us good, writes Watchman Nee, but in his saving us out of Adam and putting us in Christ. This is our reality today. For when we are in Adam in the flesh, or our soulish desires, we practice sin. And when we are in Christ in the Spirit, we practice righteousness, His righteousness. God allows us to be defeated by our self-effort to bring us to the place where we realize that we are corrupt, undependable, and beyond repair of ourselves. Then He comes to us and says, "Had enough? Since you're now out of the way, will you let me take over?" It is then a matter of being willing to let go and let God have His way with us. God has no other aim than to lead you and me to the end of ourselves so that we may know ourselves and want to be conformed to the image of His Son. Boy, that's a fantastic exchange, isn't it? Salvation is coming out of death into life. In John 5:24, Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who has sent me has everlasting life, and he does not come into judgment, but he passes from death to life." You see, John 5:24 is one of several salvation verses. What is the death that this verse speaks of? Well, according to 1 John 5:11 and 12, it says, "And this is the testimony, that God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in the Son." Verse 12 says, "He who believes in the Son has life. He who does not believe in the Son of God does not have life." Before we came to Jesus and got saved, we were spiritually dead. This is a good thing to tell the unsaved. They are dead in their trespasses, but anyone who repents and confesses of their sins, they are made alive by the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit's power that indwells them via the new birth. The world doesn't know or even think about having a relationship with God. It's up to us believers to inform them that God offers a relationship with them through His Son. If you asked an unsaved person, "Are you saved?" and they answer, "I feel like I am," let them know they are deceived, that salvation is a matter of truth, not a matter of feelings that vacillate. Our salvation and or justification is entirely from God. And if this is true of the beginning of our salvation, it is also true of all that follows. As we are sanctified, if the source of our life is in God, so also is everything that follows. Nothing starts from us. God initiates it all. God cuts short our old self-will nature to make way for our new nature in Christ, which works in willing cooperation with Him. Thus, the Spirit moves to attain God's ends by His own means. This is the goal of all God's dealings with His own. Whatever is of the flesh is death, and whatever is of the Spirit is life. John 6:63. You can tell people who agree with you about God's salvation but reject the Lord that they are proud, even too proud to admit they are wrong. Just as no inverted cup can receive water, so no proud person is able or willing to accept the salvation of God. According to the Bible, salvation is related primarily to the world, not to hell. The opposite of salvation is the world. And as long as we belong to the world, we are not saved from it. So salvation is also a matter of position. As long as a person is in Adam, walking according to the course of the world, he or she stands opposite to God, making him an enemy. This also the unsaved need to know. When they say to you, I'm not into hurting God or anyone in any way. Nee also said, a prime characteristic of New Testament salvation is that God has not only given salvation to us, but after he has given it, he starts to build it in us through patient inworking. This has to do with progressive sanctification through the Holy Spirit. It is by the joining together of these two processes that we see full salvation. The one is a gift that comes from Christ. The other is incorporated through the discipline of the Holy Spirit. Through the death of the Lord Jesus, we are delivered from all that belongs to Adam, the natural. By his resurrection, we can enter into all that belongs to Christ, the supernatural. Salvation shows the grace of God because he does not recompense us according to our sins, but rather saves all who believe in the Lord Jesus. 2 Timothy 1:9. Saving sinners is his act of grace. Rewarding saints is his act of righteousness. At this point, let's briefly summarize. Salvation is a coming out of death and refers to our receiving life. Therefore, the life-giving of the Holy Spirit is salvation. All that is for us belongs to salvation. That which is in us belongs to holiness. And whatever is through us refers to ministry. What is done for us is salvation. Romans 6 belongs to salvation. It speaks of co-death and co-crucifixion with Christ, especially Romans 6:6. I'm crucified with Christ. Co-death pertains exclusively to salvation. Co-death, co-crucifixion. We are crucified with Christ. Whatever is in Christ belongs to salvation. All that is in us is related to holiness, and all that comes out from us pertains to ministry. You see, these constitute a basic knowledge of the Word of God, which we must have. Salvation is saving us out of Adam and putting us in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 15:22 says, as in Adam, all die, in Christ all are made alive. Okay, at this juncture, I'd like to talk about conscience and salvation. First of all, let's define conscience. What is your conscience? But before we define it, I'd like to say that our conscience is an important part of the four parts of us. The other three, of course, being spirit, soul, and body. You cannot escape yourself. Romans 1:20 says that, for your conscience is part of you, and each person knows what his conscience says. Conscience is the voice which God puts within each human, telling him what is right and wrong. Animals don't have conscience, only humans do. That's in Genesis 1:26. Conscience is a natural plumb line, a divider which separates between right and wrong. It is one tool that Jesus uses to guide us. Disney's Pinocchio said, let your conscience be your guide. Well, that's a bit extreme. The Holy Spirit is our guide into all the truth, but our conscience is certainly a guide. Our conscience cannot save us, but is rather a goad or a prick, urging us to do right. The flesh tries not to listen, and when we do not, we end up miserable, because as Jesus said, it hurts for you to kick against the goads, Acts 26:14. Now, there's different types of consciences. There's weak, strong, guilty, pure, and clear. Conscience has to do with strength. You either have a weak conscience or you have a strong one. The opposite of a strong or weak conscience is when a person has that, they're in constant worry and fear. On the other hand, if you practice listening to your conscience, it will get stronger and your confidence will increase. this is important in witnessing. You have more confidence to witness if you have a clear conscience. The difference between a clear or guilty conscience is another matter. When we listen to our conscience, we get a clear conscience. So we take pains to listen to that voice within us that says, this is the way, walk in it. Isaiah 30:21. Okay, this Bible study about conscience, this part of it, works from the inside out, not from the outside in. You can't escape your conscience. Both the saved and the unsaved have a conscience, and we must listen to our consciences. You're going to let them know that in witnessing. The result of not listening is that it will eventually get seared, and doing evil won't faze you. Now remember, our conscience cannot save us. Conscience was one of the ways on which God tried to base his relationship with man, that each would listen to his conscience and so be obedient to God's commandment. But it came to nothing. For example, the period in the Judges before Saul was made king, in Judges 21:25, each man did what was right in his own eyes. When Jonah was told to go to Nineveh and witness to the Ninevites and didn't in rebellion, he ran away from God. He thought he could escape his conscience and the truth, but he couldn't. The problem is that nobody listens to his conscience, just as no one keeps the law. Everyone's conscience says that the Ten Commandments are correct, so that when we disobey our conscience, we disobey the law. Everyone is responsible to listen to his conscience and is able to do so. Yet because man has not followed his conscience and has turned away from listening to God, God in his mercy and love sent his only Son to reconcile us to him. Jesus gives us a new and clear conscience when we get saved, and he begins to lead us anew through our consciences by his Holy Spirit. People don't have the power to resist their conscience. When they get the Holy Spirit, they have the power to resist, and they're more into doing right than doing wrong. So what's the purpose of conscience? In order to learn the purpose of our consciences, we must find out the reason why God gave us a conscience. It was because of our own willingness to hide real problems, because of sin in us and our not wanting to come to the light. So God put a natural plumb line in us by which he could lead us. The purpose of our conscience is not to save us, although some who do not know of Jesus may be saved through following their consciences. We are all guided by something, and Gentiles without the law may yet do what the law requires because God has written the law on their hearts. You see, there are three witnesses in how we ought to walk as believers: the Holy Spirit, the Word, and conscience. And conscience gives us a head start. Now, the warfare between God and the devil goes on, and our conscience shows us the clear difference between the two sides of right and wrong. Conscience judges a person at that moment. It is the voice within which convicts a person on the spot. The pangs of conscience admonish us so that we may learn to walk in obedience to the Lord. Conscience has to do with the law. It is a plumb line which God uses to guide us into what is right and convict us when we do wrong. Now, the Christian gets a clear conscience and a more tender conscience when he gets saved. The backslider eventually destroys his conscience, and the unsaved has the opportunity to be faithful to his darkened conscience, although without Jesus, he has not the strength to do so. You see, we have the power to listen to or disregard our conscience when Jesus saves us. We enlist one plumb line, which is conscience. We also use it in examining ourselves in the light of the gospel. But there is no examining ourselves without our conscience. If they are clear, then our hearts will not condemn us, as Job's did not in Job 27, verse 6. You see, truth and conscience go together, and our consciences respect the open statement of the truth, as found in 2 Corinthians 4, 2. You see, if your conscience is bothering you, you can't be confident nor upright. As I mentioned before, when you go out witnessing, it's going to trouble you, and they're going to pick up on it, people that you witness to. When we're not listening to our conscience, we're inviting tragedy. There's a certain love of danger and mortgaging of the future when our sin eventually finds us out. Some, by rejecting conscience, have made shipwreck of their faith, and so it's no light matter. Hebrews 2, 1 and 3. You see, people give silly excuses for their actions, but eventually their consciences get broken down. Once the conscience is broken down, they work against the truth, and you break out altogether. And then the person becomes a law unto themselves, according to Romans 1, 24 and 25. They feel no more pain, and their consciences are seared and no longer bother them. It can get to that point, that plight. The alternative is wasting our lives going around and round in fear when we have a guilty conscience, and always wondering if we should have done this or that. When we do wrong, our conscience bothers us, and we pretty clearly know why. For example, if you make a vow and you break it, your conscience bothers you. If you hear verses about helping others and you commit yourself to do it, you don't do it, that's going to bother us. And so you'll say something, well, that verse applies to me, and you're going to be convicted. That's how conscience affects us on the inside. The devil has a plan, and he trains his demons to go out and try to get us to go against our conscience. His work is to work through our flesh to break down our conscience so that we have no plumb line and no distinct voice within us. And the bugle gives an indistinct sound. We don't know whether to advance or retreat, the Bible says. And then we could get to the point where our conscience is seared and we no longer have a standard by which to walk. How do we get a clear conscience? Well, all that is required is that one genuinely admit that Jesus is Lord and not resist his will. If you're not going to resist his will, you're going to have a clear conscience. And we must practice having a clear conscience and so train our faculties to distinguish between good and evil. That's found in Hebrews 5:14. Now we're going to talk about conscience and Jesus. Exactly what connection is there between Jesus and our consciences? Our conscience respect the open statement of the truth, which I mentioned. And since Jesus is the truth in John 14:6, our conscience respects Jesus. Thus, the human conscience, even in its weakened state, is a very useful vehicle in arriving at repentance. Now, a little on conscience when saved, but when we genuinely get saved, we receive the power through the Holy Spirit to listen to our conscience, and we're able to please Jesus. We work out our own salvation in fear and trembling, partly by looking to and obeying our conscience through which the Holy Spirit works. If we do that, then our conscience remains tender and we don't get corrupted or defiled. And we ought to live in fear of sin, in fear that we will not do what it... We ought to live in fear of sin, in fear that we will not do what is right, lest we start walking on our consciences. Real unity in Jesus and fellowshipping in listening to our conscience is essential to our walk with Jesus in the light. We have to bring to the light the shameful things that devour us, that we know we did wrong, that we're hiding, in order to overcome and put them to death. The prodigal son, what did he say? I will arise and go to my father. Okay? He came to his right mind. He finally listened to his conscience. Okay, let's talk about the critical one, since our ministry is about witnessing. Witnessing and conscience. In order to be able to rightly draw others to Jesus, it is extremely important to continue listening to our conscience, especially in the area of witnessing, seeking opportunities to make Jesus known. Otherwise, if we become lazy in obeying our conscience and return to the ways of the flesh, there is no strength to overcome in witnessing. So it is important to realize how our conscience affects our witnessing. We must be hoping in Jesus in a real way, because it is our spirits which really speak to the unsaved. We can sense when they are being honest, and they can also sense when we are being honest. Philippians 1:28. Jesus requires us to give the teaching an example of truth in our lives, and so commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Since Jesus has given both the unsaved and the saved a conscience, it is a common denominator among all people, which is helpful in witnessing. The Holy Spirit can convict a person through their conscience. It is therefore important to appeal to a person's conscience with truth. Okay? All right, so much on conscience. Now I'd like to mention, well, there was a little bit more I'd like to mention, what Watchman Nee has to say on it. Watchman Nee writes, "While we were sinners, our spirit was thoroughly dead. Our conscience was therefore dead, as well as unable to function normally. This does not mean the conscience of a sinner stops working altogether. It does continue to operate, though in a state of coma. Whenever it comes out of this coma, it does nothing but condemn the sinner. It has no strength to lead men to God. Dead as it is to the Lord, God nonetheless desires to perform some work in the heart of man. In initiating his work of salvation, the first step of the Holy Spirit is to awaken this comatose conscience. The Spirit of God shakes and enlightens this darkened conscience so as to convince the sinner of his violation of God's law and of his inability to answer God's righteous demand, and additionally to convict him as one who is condemned and who deserves nothing but perdition. If one's conscience is willing to confess whatever sins have been committed, including the sin of unbelief, it will be sorrowful in a godly way, earnestly desiring the mercy of God. In John 16:8, Jesus said, "When the Holy Spirit comes, he will convince the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Should a man's conscience be closed to conviction, however, then he can never be saved. The Holy Holy Spirit illuminates a sinner's conscience with the light of God's law, so as to convict him of sin. The same Spirit also enlightens man's conscience with the light of the gospel, so as to save him. If a sinner, upon being convicted of a sin and hearing the gospel of God's grace, is willing to accept the gospel and by faith take it, he will see how the precious blood of the Lord Jesus answers all the accusations of his conscience. What ground is left for accusation, since sin's penalty has been fully paid? The blood of the Lord has atoned for all the sins of a believer. Hence, there is no more condemnation in the conscience. Our salvation is confirmed by the fact that the precious blood of Christ has quieted this voice of condemnation. Since the terrifying light of the law and the merciful light of the gospel both shine upon conscience, dare we overlook man's conscience in the preaching of the word? Is our aim in preaching merely to make people understand in their mind, be moved in their emotion, and decide with their will without even in the slightest way touching their conscience? The Holy Spirit cannot do the work of regeneration through the precious blood of the Lord if one's conscience has not been convicted of sin. It's that simple. In witnessing, we must stress the precious blood of Christ. Oh, the blood. And the conscience alike. These two must be presented equally. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? That's Hebrews 9:14, a beautiful verse. You see, as a believer's conscience is cleansed, he or she is regenerated. The Christian must not have the slightest accusation in his conscience. He must be assured that his every sin is entirely atoned for by the blood of the Lamb, and that now there is no charge against him. A believer's conscience is quickened or made alive when his spirit is regenerated and his conscience is purified. Man must obey the inner voice of conscience, as I mentioned. We should not try to ease our conscience when we refuse to obey the inner voice by resorting to good works as a cover-up. This is just replacing God's will with good deeds. That's an Adam and Eve fig leaf number. Conscience simply demands our obedience. We can serve God only with a clear conscience. 2 Timothy 1:3, a guilty conscience will cause one to shrink back intuitively from God. Our salvation depends a lot on whether we will continue to trust God daily. The unsaved need to know God can take care and provide for them far better than they can. When I witness, I sometimes say, Father knows best. God is not immune to people's suffering. He's certainly able to sympathize with what they go through. Look what he went through on the cross. You certainly can tell him that. Nor is he unconcerned about their lives. For he ever lives in heaven, praying for their salvation. Just because the unsaved keep God out of their lives doesn't mean he doesn't exist. This too make them aware of. You know, there's a purpose of our salvation in 2 Corinthians 6:1. Working together with him, we also urge you not to receive the grace of God in vain. And how would that be? Well, we're not saved for eternal salvation only. God has saved us for himself to be co-workers with him. We are called to be co-laborers, working with the Lord in unity as his church to make Jesus known and make disciples of nations. That's the mandate. Any endeavor outside of being a co-worker with the Lord is in vain. It will come to nada, nothing. The harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. We are told to pray for workers to go out into the harvest. This is good to do, but let us also go ourselves. me back up a little because I wanted to talk to you about assurance of salvation. And give me a moment to find it. There we go. Then there's the assurance of salvation. Is it possible for you to know that your sins are forgiven? Can you be sure that you are on your way to heaven? What about the fear of God's judgment and the frightening possibility of going to hell? Can you know without any doubt that God has saved you from the eternal consequences of sin? These questions we as believers need to know the answers for, so we can ask the unsaved these very questions. Of course, the question we would ask the unsaved, the question would be, if you died today, do you know for sure you'll go to heaven? People would answer either yes or no, or they would be undecided, something in between. But some people are saved and doubt their salvation. And then there are religious people who are deceitful about being saved, and others who are deceived and think they are saved. There are all types of people you're going to encounter in witnessing. So you really need to know the Bible and ask certain questions to see whether the unsaved, where they're coming from. Some people don't want to look bad, so they'll say that they're saved, although they're not. Ask them, what's your testimony? How did you get saved? How did you come to a saving faith in Jesus? What they say will either give them away as deceitful liars, or they did, in fact, get saved. If a person says God is love, and he won't send anyone to hell, well, you know what that's all about. The Bible says, note the kindness and severity of the Lord. You know that God wants no one to perish. That's him being loving. But if they snub their noses at God, they don't want him in their life, God will judge the wicked and their own words will condemn them to hell. He doesn't send them there. If an unsaved person asks you, a believer, how do you know you're saved and going to heaven? What would you say? I would say to that person, because I've accepted Jesus as my Savior, I can be sure my salvation is genuine because of my obedience to Him. Because you know what it says in 1 John 2:3? Now by this we know that we know Him, if we keep or obey His commandments. A.W. Tozer said, the man that believes will obey. Failure to obey is convincing proof that there is not true faith present. Unquote. If our lives are marked by obedience to Christ, it is another powerful reason to be sure we belong to Him. Besides that, the finished work of Christ, our personal faith in Him, and our love for God and our fellow believer are evidences of true saving faith. God intends for Christians to be sure of their salvation. For that reason, He has established a solid bedrock of truth, the Bible's authority, with scripture like 1 John 3:24, by this we know that He abides in us, by the Spirit whom He has given us. The Holy Spirit confirms in our heart what we already believe to be true. Our experience of the new birth squares with Romans 8:16. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and so we are. If people say they are saved but cannot tell you about receiving the Holy Spirit within their heart, you can flat out tell them they aren't saved. The inner witness of the Holy Spirit is necessary as an evidence one is indeed saved. Okay, in closing, I'd like to just close with a few verses. We have 8 more minutes left. And a statement by David Jeremiah, which I mentioned before, that bears repeating. I'd like to close with 5 verses in reference to salvation. Having said what I've said, Hebrews 2:3 says, how shall we escape? Escape what? God's wrath, his judgment, if we neglect so great a salvation. Luke 21:28 says, "Look up, because your redemption or your salvation is at hand." Romans 13:11-12 says, "For salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed." In witnessing, 1 Chronicles 16:23, it says, "Tell of his salvation from day to day." You know, when we get to heaven, we'll be part of the multitude, the faithful overcoming multitude, who will say this in unison: "Salvation belongs to our God who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb." Wow. That's in Revelation 7, verse 10. Now, I'd like to, final closing would be from David Jeremiah. He said this: "There are only two things that are eternal, the word of God and souls of men." That's what every Christian and church should be investing in daily. Once again, 1 Chronicles 16:23 says, "Tell of his salvation from day to day." And so that concludes another Bible study. We hope you enjoyed it. We thank you for you spending your time with us this evening. And I'd just like to say that the next Bible study that I'll be doing anyway, Ray will have next week, and he'll be continuing his series. But last week I finished on what is a Christian. We just finished up what is salvation. And the next time we get together, we're going to be covering what is Christianity. To tell you what's further down the road, I'm going to be here and there doing some end time Bible studies, and we're going to be doing an interesting one on the Laodicean church, the lukewarm church, which unfortunately this 21st century has. And the title of it is an interesting title. Of course, I can't divulge that to you now to give it away. The placebo investment. It's a very interesting one by a brother who had an interesting testimony that I'll be able to share with you. His name is Pittman, Brother Pittman. And I had the good experience of meeting him, fellowship with him, and be under one of his Bible studies through a friend of mine, a brother of mine. So we're down to 5 minutes, and I always enjoy this time because it's whatever God puts in my heart to share with you. Like to say this, that another Bible study that I'll be doing that I think is very, very important, it has to do with the end, and we're going to be doing a lot of end time Bible studies, eschatology. Why? Because it couldn't be more important a time, relevant a time is the time that we're in. We're in the last days. What better thing to get into? There are churches that do not get into prophecy. They into general prophecy just about Jesus, but they're not into the Bible prophecy about the last days, which I just don't understand that. But another Bible study that I'll be doing, and will be just on preparation, and it'll be covering two books in the Old Testament, Ruth and Esther. And you know, preparation, God preparing us, is found in both Ruth and Esther. I talked to a sister, a friend of mine in our ministry, and she didn't believe that. Oh yeah, yeah. Well, it's interesting that what comes up in the Word, sometimes it comes from a source you wouldn't think of. But to tell you the truth, aside from having a relationship with Jesus, aside from my dear wife, Robin, who I love dearly, and my family and brothers and sisters, my joy is children and what I get from the Word. When God shows from the Word, it's my joy. When that is not in my life, oh, you don't want to be around me. And you get grumpy and all that stuff. But it's something how the Word encourages, trains us, convicts us, motivates us, uplifts us. It's Christ. It's all Christ. I have a book that I gave to a friend in the fellowship, and it's Christ's the sum of all things. He's our everything. He is our everything. And thank God he is. Because like the scripture says, apart from him, we can do nothing. You know, the simple things we forget. His love, his mercy, his grace. If it wasn't for his grace, and grace is what God does for us, we wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be speaking to you. He saved us from so much as we got into the world, self, our soul, Satan, and hell. He saved us so much. Blessed be his holy name. Praise your holy name, Lord, and thank you so much. Thank you for using me this evening to share your wonderful life-giving word to bless your people. I always look forward to it. I try to give everyone that hears the best, and the best is you. And when that comes out, and I feel that came out somewhat tonight, and I thank you that that's happened. I thank all people who pray for us during these webcasts, and I thank my dear Robin, who every time does when I ask her, she certainly prays. May God richly bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he keep your going out and your coming in. May he be with you in your rising and your retiring. It's always a blessing and to share with you, and I always look forward to doing it. And this is what it's all about. Once again, I thank you, Lord, for having the privilege of coming on the air and sharing with the brothers and sisters. And if I can help in any way, if you need help, don't hesitate to call us. We look forward to your questions, comments, and any prayer requests you have. And if you feel led to finance this ministry in any way, we would accept it with gratitude. We thank you so much once again for tuning in. And it's always a pleasure to serve you and through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I don't normally do this on the closing, but I'll say, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. If anything, in my own personal walk, I like the fact that God is changing me on the inside and purifying my heart, so I'm not double-minded anymore. Because a double-minded man will not receive anything from the Lord. It's just that way. His way is the only way. And it hurts for us, the verse I mentioned before, when we kick against the goads. We don't want to go against God in any way, shape, or form. Even Shakespeare said, to thy own self be true. How much more should we be true to God? To be worthy of the gospel to which we've been called. O Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Remember the lost. You might be the only one that needs to hear what you have, that the unsaved need to hear from. You might be the only one. So share what you have for others, and the Lord will bless you. Once again, may his face shine upon you and give you encouragement. Don't be upset when you're weak, because when you're weak in him, he is strong in you. Remember God's promises. In all things, give thanks, and do everything without grumbling and murmuring. Your attitude is important, but where your treasure is, there is your heart also. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me. By his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. And without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend it or overcome it. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own home, and his own people received him not. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who believed in his name, who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we behold his glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, Jesus, full of grace and truth. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Now this is the testimony of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask, "Who are you?" He confessed. He did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ," John the Baptist saying it. And they asked him, "What then, are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." But they said to him, "Who are you, that we may give answer to those who sent us? What do you say about yourself? He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said. We need to be a voice in the body of Christ. Amen. We have to be a voice. And that's just the way it is. And so, once again, I want to say thank you for joining in with us. And we hope to see you again. Same time, same station. Until then, Lord permitting, God bless you. So carry